pensé. Good afternoon. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as we gather here for the commencement convocation of America's oldest historically black college and university, Wilberforce University, class of 2004. To the bishops, Bishop Robert Webster, who is the bishop of this, the 3rd Episcopal District, Bishop Bashtai McKenzie of the 18th Episcopal District, who was our preacher for the baccalaureate service this morning, John Walker, who is chairman of the Board of Trustees and members of the trustee board, Dr. Lear Gaskin Fitzhugh, who is the president of our sister institution, Payne Theological Seminary, to the alumni of Wilberforce University, the administration, the faculty, the members of the those who will receive the honorary degrees, to the parents, the grandparents, the friends, and others who have come to share in this joyous celebration, we greet you today. The program is before you. It is printed. At this time, we will have the hymn of adoration, "To God Be the Glory," which will be followed by the invocation by the Reverend John S. Herring, Sr., and then greetings by the Chancellor of the Board, Bishop Webster, Senior Class President Robert Carter, and the Adult and Continuing Education Representative, K.L. Rotchen, in that order.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved the world that he gave us his, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Come to the Father through Jesus, Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done, great things. And great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son, but purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus Son and give him the glory. Great things he hath done.
Shall we pray? Most gracious and all-wise God, we come to you this afternoon thanking you for all of your many blessings. Thanking you, God, for this institution that you have allowed to educate individuals throughout its years. Thanking you, Lord, for its administration, its staff. Thanking you, God, for all the those that are behind the wheels of Wilberforce University. Father, we come today to celebrate with these graduates and thanking you for the journey that they have made thus far in their life. We thank you, first of all, that they know you, and we pray that they have accepted you as their Son and Savior. Father, bless this service. Bless this commencement. We pray right now. We know that you're here, but we're inviting you to come in and dwell with us. Help us to let go, Father God, and let you have your way. Bless all that I'm duty-bound to pray for. Bless the speaker of this hour. Bless, Lord Jesus, these individuals as they go forth into this world, looking towards you, the author and the finisher of their faith. Help them to be what you have them to be, for you have a purpose for their life. Lord Jesus, bless their families. Bless their friends. Again, we pray that you bless this institution, that they may continue to educate your people. These blessings and all blessings we ask in Jesus' name, our Savior and your Son, we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Certainly, as Chancellor of the Board of Wilberforce University, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to bring greetings from the Third Episcopal District of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. For almost 150 years, we look forward to you coming during this season, where we prepare students to go out into the world and make a difference. We greet you because Wilberforce University, the oldest college for people of color, we feel that we are the precursors in the field of education, especially when it comes to historical black colleges. We bring greetings because you make us what we are. The Third Episcopal District is a small district, but it is a large district in reality. It is large because Wilberforce University is located in the Third Episcopal District. It is large because Payne Theological Seminary is located in this district. So we come today saying to you, we wish for you the best. We pray that you might go and give the very best that you've received from this institution. And I'd like to say instructions end in the classroom, but education ends with life. As long as they make books, you ought to be a scholar. As long as there is a learning process going on, you ought to take advantage of it. For I believe that the only thing that limits you, not your size, not your color, not how tall you are, but the only thing that limits you today is your idea. Therefore, develop a good idea and think big. Secular education might make you clever, but it doesn't make you good. So I say to you today, take God with you wherever you go. Remember that God can make a difference in your life. Somebody said, education makes a strong race. Therefore, we're depending on you to make us even stronger than where we are. God bless you and God keep you. And make sure you look to him who is the author and finisher of your faith in all that you do.
Protocol already been established. You know, as I sat by myself last night and I began to think, and I've come to the realization that the Lord our God works in mysterious ways. And he sometimes places us in a position that we really don't understand. And because we don't understand, being the human beings that we are, we try to redirect God's will for our lives to what and how we think that it should be. I am reminded of a scripture that says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him and he will direct thy path. I say this because had someone told me that I would be standing at a podium on this day as the senior class president of the graduating class of 2004, here at Wilberforce University in the cornfields of old Ohio, I would have probably told them to go and seek counseling. But because my faith in God is so strong, I knew that I was strategically placed here at Wilberforce University for a purpose and a time such as this. First and foremost, I would like to thank God, who is the author and the finisher of my faith, for allowing me to stand here before you on today. I would also like to thank our support system. And by support system, I mean all of those who have sent money on numerous occasions, prayed, gave words of encouragement, and also have lent an ear just to listen. I think I can speak on behalf of the entire class of 2004 by saying thank you from the bottom of our hearts. I would like to take a minute or two to encourage those of you, because there may be some people here who feel that they are not capable of accomplishing the goals that they have set for themselves in life. And to do that, I must refer back to my own personal testimony, because I have spent 17 of my 24 years living in the projects in Chicago, Illinois. I've been confronted with drugs, gangs, and violence. Now, I could have fallen victim to what society has set before me, but I decided to take all of that negativity, and turn it into a positive stepping stone that will take me to the next level in life. I decided to go to college so that I could receive an education to better myself as a person, also to be placed in a position to give back and help those who are unable to help themselves. I say this to remind you that no matter what obstacles are placed in front of you or what problems you may encounter, always remember that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Not just some things, but all things. And also remember that God will never put more on you than you can bear. Last but not least, to the graduating class of 2004. You know, it's kind of funny that over the last few weeks, when asked, how do you feel about graduating? Many of us replied by simply saying, "I'm kind of scared." And the reason being is that some of us may not have a job yet. We probably didn't get accepted into the school of our choice. And maybe we don't even have a place to live. But how many of you know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning? I stopped by here today to tell you that if you don't remember anything else that I've said today, remember this: what's to come is better than what's been. We are a class that is daring to aspire and determined to succeed. Congratulations, thank you, and God bless you. Can I have the class of 2004 please stand to your feet? To our president, Dr. Floyd H. Flake, on behalf of the graduating class of 2004, we would like to present Wilberforce University with a check of $10,000.
I will ask Mr. John Walker, our chairman, to come and on behalf of the university receive the award. He told me it's not in here, but so we will figure out what the buddy is later on. But we do want to thank the class. Thank you, John.
Thank you, class of 2004. I just said to someone, this is better than some of our board members. But we pray that God will be with you as you go out into the world. And we certainly will put this money to good use for other students coming behind you. Thank you so much, and God bless.
I'd like to welcome all of you here this afternoon. It's an honor to be the representative for the class 2004 for adult and continuing education. Something that we have learned through our doing and completing our thesis is that you need to acknowledge your sources. Therefore, I would like to give thanks to God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I consider when I was asked to speak today on behalf of CLIME, the adult continuing education, I felt I was not worthy. But I feel honored that I was able to speak on behalf of my peers and on behalf of my colleagues. I just like to say that I am very proud to be a part of this university and a part of the class in which I'm graduating with today and the faculty thereof that taught us. You know, Wilberforce University got its name from Mr. Wilberforce out of England that sought to abolish slavery in all the English colonies. Today, that has been abolished. Sin has been abolished by Christ upon the cross. Also, but there still remains one slavery that we must defeat, and those of us who are in this education must defeat the slavery of ignorance. Ignorance, according to Webster, is not knowing, the lack of knowledge. We as graduates must put and abolish this slavery once and for all. Regardless of race, regardless of color, culture, we have the victory in Christ and the knowledge given to us by this university. CLIME represents the credentials for lifelong learning and management and in business. There's one on the program of CLIME. When you get your bulletin, there's two mountain peaks with a partial sunrise behind it. Well, I can tell you, it has been a climb. But today, that sun is not shining just a little bit. It's brightly shining today. And we give thanks for that. I would like to give thanks to Dr. Mora, Ms. Tony Preston, Elizabeth Carter, because without them, there's no way this could be accomplished. In conclusion, again, we have a responsibility as students, as graduates. We never stop being students. We're always learning to the day the Lord takes us. But we do have a responsibility, and that is to give back to the university something that they have given to us. And that is, we can represent this university and the Klein program in one of three ways. First and foremost, we can pray that the same opportunity that has been given to us, others also can receive this opportunity. Two, we can give financially. We can come back and offer financially with scholarships, the presentations made today, so that others can have the same opportunity that we also have. Three, we can come back, and as we live our lives, we are a living advertisement, a living testimony of what we've received at this university. Encourage all those that are in the same positions we were, working adults, children, grandparents, parents, brothers and sisters in Christ that encouraged us. Tell them to finish their degree. There is a way. Lord Jesus, thank you, and God bless all of you.
I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes. I'm gonna pray till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna pray till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna pray till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna pray till Jesus. Can't you feel the Spirit move?
Can't you feel it?
I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till Jesus comes. I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till the Spirit moves in my heart. I'm gonna shout till Jesus comes.
Let's give the choir another hand. We want to thank our young people for staying. A year or so ago, when I was asked to take the appointment as president of Wilberforce University, one of the persons that I called to enlist support of was Earl Graves. He invited himself last year to, as a measure of that support, to come and speak for our commencement, and then we found that our schedules did not mesh, and so he said, I will come next year. So he has been on the schedule for an entire year to come as our speaker for this year. He wanted to do it, and certainly we wanted to have him here. Earl Graves represents to us one of the most high profile of African American leaders in this nation before we had those who now are the African American leaders in the Fortune 500 companies. This was the voice that spoke for inclusion, the voice that spoke for economic parity in America. And he did it not only in terms of his verbal speaking, but he did it by creating Black Enterprise Magazine, a magazine that if you read it, you will discover that it is one of the most profound of all of the financial magazines that are on the newsstand. I read Fortune every month. I read Money Magazine every month. But I read first Black Enterprise, and I find that they offer as good advice as you can find in any publication that is on the newsstands. He is one of the greatest of persons as it relates to offering advice, giving support, giving counsel, providing means of access to other persons who might be able to help in whatever situation you find yourself in. As the president and founder, chief executive officer of Earl G. Graves Limited, he also has expanded his business opportunities. He is also one of the founders, the chairman and CEO of Pepsi-Cola, Washington, D.C., a minority-controlled Pepsi-Cola franchise here in the United States of America, and is also a general partner in Egoli Beverages, which is the Pepsi-Cola franchise in South Africa. He has received the 84th NAACP Spingarn Award and is listed among the 100 top business persons, certainly in New York and in this country. I believe that at hearing him, you will conclude also that here is a man of great resolve, a great determination, a man who has been able to think outside of the box and to move a people from merely concentrating on social and political paradigms to an understanding of what it means to be able to function within the framework of the educational and economic paradigms that define the country and the world in which we live. I present to you this morning Mr. Earl Graves, our speaker for this 2004 commencement of Wilberforce University.
Reverend Flake, first, thank you for that very warm introduction as an old friend. Graduates, parents and relatives, President Flake again, honored officials, trustees, faculty and staff, alumni, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm deeply honored to welcome the outstanding Wilberforce University class of 2004 to a new era of opportunity. You're supposed to applaud for yourselves at that one, right? It is indeed a privilege to speak at Wilberforce, our nation's oldest historically Black university, and certainly one of its most distinguished. While I'm humbled by this institution's 157-year history, I'm just as humbled to be standing on the same stage as your university president, my very dear friend, the Reverend Dr. Floyd Flake. There aren't many individuals who command the respect that he has earned. He served with distinction in the United States Congress. As pastor of the Allen Amy Church in Queens, New York, he stands as the head of that community's spiritual and economic renewal. And when the call came to serve his alma mater as his president, he did not hesitate to answer. I'm not trying to sound as if Reverend Flakes walks on water, but Mel Gibson did interview him and audition him for that part in that recent movie. Seriously, I think that we all need to show our respect and appreciation for Wilberforce President Reverend Dr. Floyd Flake. I'm also flattered to be receiving an honorary degree today along with three outstanding national leaders, Dr. Julian Earls, Dr. Yvonne Walker-Taylor, and Bishop Murphy McKenzie. Let me say to you at the outset this afternoon, whatever I do with the rest of my life, I will not come behind Dr. McKenzie as a speaker ever again. I'm honored that the Wilberforce trustee and longtime friend John Mourning is here. 6 months after my one-time boss, Robert Kennedy, was assassinated, and I figured out what I wanted to do with my life, someone suggested that I reach out to a certain young graphic artist. Well, that was John Mourning. He designed my company logo 36 years ago, and today he continues to be a valued friend and advisor in business. He deserves our appreciation as well, John Mourning. Finally, we must pay tribute to the parents and loved ones here this morning. Mother's Day is next week. So this is for the mothers in the audience. You've made big sacrifices. You all have got to follow the script. The mothers in this audience have made big sacrifices, but today you are rewarded with an even bigger sense of pride for what your youngsters have accomplished. In turn, you deserve to know how much these young people appreciate you. Graduates, please stand and show your appreciation for mom, dad, your friends, and your relatives. Now, Reverend Flake said if I tried this, I probably wouldn't get you back in your seats. For me to say I'm happy to be here is an understatement. As some of you may know, just 8 weeks ago, I underwent major surgery for prostate cancer. I came through fine. The prognosis is excellent. Fortunately, the cancer was detected early, and for that I'm grateful to God that I get my health checked regularly. There were five physicians at Howard University whom I entrust with my health care, all African American and among the best in the business. During a routine checkup, my urologist didn't like my PSA score and ordered a biopsy. I wasn't worried at first, and then came the word. It was cancer. I won't lie, I was devastated. But once my life and my wife of 44 years and I accepted what we were facing, became a matter of informing ourselves, getting the right treatment, and putting our trust in the Almighty. By now, you're looking at your watches and wondering, why is this old guy talking to me about his health problems? Doesn't he realize we're in our 20s, unless he's blind also? Well, the reason I'm asked to speak at occasions like this is because people like you want my advice on how to be successful. Rule number one, don't die. African Americans have the highest incidence of prostate cancer in the world. We suffer disproportionately from health disease, diabetes, and other life-threatening illnesses. Factors such as stress, diet, lifestyle choices, and generally poor access to quality medical care in our communities all play a part. These are the things you have to hear about now, not when you're my age. Poor health limits what you can do. And if you have big ambitions, and I know you do, your body's going to have to be able to deliver. So take care of it. End of health lecture. Now, I'd like to take a moment, like us to take a moment to consider the larger significance of this occasion. Wilberforce was created 150 years ago to uplift African Americans at a time when teaching a black child to read and write was a crime in many states. It's fitting then that this commencement coincides with the 50th anniversary of Brown versus the Board of Education, the U.S. Supreme Court ruling that ended segregation in education. Lead attorney Thurgood Marshall attended a historically black school, Howard University, because the University of Maryland rejected him on the basis of color. Just a few years later, Marshall's legal brilliance would convince the Supreme Court that separate but equal really meant separate and inferior. The decision would force the University of Maryland and every other American institution to abandon the policy of racial exclusion. Now, what does the Brown victory mean to you today, 50 years later? For one thing, it means that you attended this historically black university not because you had to, but because you chose to. You elected to be part of the tradition of the social transformation that Wilberforce represents. To do that, you must be just as committed to excellence, just as dedicated to the welfare of our people as those who came before you, because the challenges you face are as great as any time in our history. We are a nation at war. American troops are dying every day. The global consequences of our presence in Iraq will certainly be with us for some years to come, and you have to confront them. 50 years after Brown, African Americans still face disparities in health, education, and the workplace. The legal precedents that Marshall and others helped set under constant threat by the far right are still there. And in this uncertain economy, you certainly have your work cut out for you. I only need to ask, how many of you graduating today already have a job lined up? Raise hands. If your hand isn't raised yet, don't panic. First of all, your parents are going to give you at least 2 more weeks in the house. But I say to you, just resolve to work harder for whatever you're after. There's a placard in my office that is not unlike what the bishop was speaking to earlier this morning. And it says, education is not a preparation for life. Education is life itself. The meaning is simple. Your education does not end today. It's only just begun. You must constantly strive to improve yourself, to develop your skills, to make your mark, and opportunities will present themselves. More importantly, you will be prepared to take full advantage of them. Being prepared also means presenting yourselves as professionals. I've been in business now in almost 40 years. I serve on the boards of 6 major corporations. And I can tell you that corporate America is not looking for people who come through the door making fashion statements. So unless you're talking to the folks at Ringling Brothers Circus, don't show up at a job interview with all your tattoos on display that day. Make your statement by expressing ideas sharply and clearly. Make it by showing up early and staying as long as it takes to get the job done. Make your statement by having the answer before your boss thinks to ask the question. What I'm saying is, the statement you make should be the life you lead. Of course, there's more to building and maintaining wealth than just finding a job. If you're anything like I was at your age, then you probably can't wait to start earning money so you can get that luxury car. Well, that's fine. You should want the best for yourselves. But consider this, that $40,000 luxury car you will buy will be worth half as much the moment you drive it out the parking lot. I'm not saying you can't have that car, graduates. I'm saying that financial stability should come before material gain. Buy a used car and move faster on your way to buying a home instead, not to mentioning paying off those student loans. Once you achieve economic stability, then you can get the car you actually can afford. I want you to remember the most important thing about financial success that I could mention this morning. You must give something back. And you can start right here with your alumni association. About 2 hours ago, President Flake handed me an envelope and said, this is for you. And I said, what is this? He said, it's your honorarium. I said, I've done pretty close to 75 graduations. I've never accepted an honorarium. I've always given it back. He said, well, how do you want to give it back? I said, well, how much does it cost to be a life member of the Alumni Association? He said, $2,500. So I found your alumni president, and I'm going to become a life member of our Alumni Association. Just as illiterate slaves once risked their lives so their children could learn to read and write, this is following also in what you can do. Your generation must make the necessary sacrifices to keep our schools alive. And don't stop there. Give back to your community by joining the local NAACP. Run for the local school board. Start a voter registration drive. Help a small black-owned business grow and expand. Start your own business and reach out for the African-American talent around you. Bring hope and inspiration and self-confidence into the lives of others. There's no need to feel guilty about enjoying the trappings of your success. None of you sacrifice the last 4 years of your lives, not to mention your parents' savings, to end up martyrs on poverty row. Just remember, success carries a price tag called responsibility. When you march out of here this afternoon, I want you to hold up your heads high and walk proudly. I want you to walk with that certain confidence that your hard work will pay off in success beyond your dreams. And here's what I want you to say to yourselves this afternoon. We still use the word march for marching out, don't we? I never get it right. Sometimes I tell my kids, do I mean to say, do I want to get up or do I want to get down when I'm dancing? I don't remember. But marching out. I want you to say to yourselves, here I am, world. Some may try to convince me that my race will limit my aspirations, but I know better. I've worked hard, and I'm prepared to compete with anyone for the opportunity to practice my profession. Every day of my life, I will strive for excellence. I will pass this way only once, and I intend to make a difference while I'm here. I want you to say to yourselves, every day people will depend on me for my skills as a professional, for my patience and understanding as a parent, and for my desire to better humanity as a member of my community. I do not intend to let any of them down. And finally, above all, I want you to say to yourselves, I will not lose the vision I see so clearly on this day. I will always remember the vision of a better world for those still trapped in the absence of equal opportunity. The vision great men and women died for so I could stand here today. That's what I want you to say to yourselves as you march out this afternoon. The choices today before you are limitless. Take a good look around. Someone in this gathering, right here, is the next Thurgood Marshall, the next Reverend Flake, the next John Mourning. Indeed, the first African-American president of the United States might be sitting right here, and perhaps, I'll be able to say I helped inspire her. Thank you, ladies. But whatever success you acquire, you must be willing to leverage that success into opportunities for all African Americans. And that's what a leader is all about. And building leaders is what Wilberforce is about. So before you leave here, graduates, I want you to show me that you're worthy to bear the weight of leadership. I'm going to issue 6 challenges. And when I issue a challenge you're willing to take on, I want you to stand and say, I accept, and stay on your feet. Now, I just heard a mother say here in the front, if that boy does not stand up. But if you're still sitting when I'm done, then you don't get your diplomas. So here we go. That was that young man's mother that spoke. If you're looking towards a career in communications, I challenge you to carry the mantle of pioneers like John Johnson to fight for accurate representation of our people. I challenge you to reject the violence and modern minstrel behavior that passes for black media representation today. Do you accept? Stay on your feet. Good. We're getting some of them out of here. If you're moving on to law school, I challenge you to carry the mantle of Thurgood Marshall and fight all attacks on liberty and equality in our courts, a battle that still continues 50 years after the Brown versus the Board of Education ruling. Do you accept? If your degree is in technology or the sciences, I challenge you to help close the technological divide so that no African American child is left behind. Do you accept? If you're set on a career in business, I challenge you to carry the mantle of A.G. Gaston and other business pioneers. I challenge you to rebuild our communities, restore confidence in the economy, create jobs, and heal the economic wounds we've suffered in the wake of war and recession. Do you accept? If you're pre-med, I challenge you to carry the mantle of Dr. Charles Drew. I challenge you to find new treatments for cancer and heart disease and diabetes and other illnesses that disproportionately affect our people. Do you accept? And finally, if you are here in preparation for a career in education, in social work, in engineering, as a member of the clergy, or any other field of endeavor, then I challenge you to carry on the Wilberforce tradition of achievement and service. I challenge you to be worthy of that tradition. I challenge you to carry the mantle of your predecessors faithfully and with honors. Those who are left, do you accept? Outstanding. Mr. President, members of the Board of Trustees and faculty, I think these young people are ready to graduate. Let them march. Thank you.
Julian M. Earls, Director of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration Glenn Research Center at Lewis Field in Cleveland, Ohio, since October 2003. As director, his duties include planning, organizing, and directing activities required to accomplish the mission assigned to the center. Dr. Earl manages an annual budget of approximately $773 million and oversees workforce of 1,920 civil service employees and 1,300 on-site support service contractors. Dr. Earls earned a bachelor's degree in physics from Norfolk State University, master's degree in radiation biology from the University of Michigan, and his doctorate in degree in radiation physics from the University of Michigan. Additionally, Dr. Earls has earned and has been awarded numerous honorary degrees. Mr. President, I have the honor of presenting Julian M. Earls for the Honorary Doctor of Humanity of Humane Letters degree.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and on behalf of Wilberforce University, Julian Earls, because of all the commitment that you have made both to Wilberforce University and to all of the historically black colleges and universities, we have benefited by your presence. We have been able to move forward in science projects because of NASA's participation, and we realize that were you not there, many of the funds that are flowing into these historically black colleges would not be doing so. And so it is with great honor that we present to you the honorary degree, together with all the rights, privileges, honors appertaining thereto, in testimony thereof, the seal of the university, signature of authorized trustees, hereby affixed on this day, May 1st, 2004.
This day belongs to the graduates. My father was a country preacher who used to say, "Blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited back." I just have to make one particular point. My bride of over 42 years, Zenobia, and I got married at the end of my sophomore year at Norfolk State University. I had no degree. I had no permanent job. I owned no home. I had no automobile. People tell me I had no nothing. 2 years later, by the time I finished Norfolk State and went to the University of Rochester School of Medicine and Dentistry for our master's degree, we had our firstborn son. We decided that Zenobia would stay at Norfolk State and complete undergraduate school before joining me in Rochester, New York. Years later, when I went to the University of Michigan, a few years after that, when I went to the Harvard Business School, by that time, we had two sons. And we decided that Zenobia would not interrupt her career as a Cleveland schools teacher. So she stayed in Cleveland taking care of two sons. She would get up in the morning, make sure they got up and got dressed, fix breakfast for them, take one off to daycare, another off to school, go teach a full day of school herself, reverse that process in the afternoon, come home, throw off her coat, kick off her shoes, fix dinner for them, see to it that they did their homework, and when they were in bed, take care of her other 36 children, her students, by correcting papers and calling them. And she did that so that I could achieve. So everywhere I go in this universe, I borrow from Gladys Knight and her used-to-be Pips, if you will, because I say if anyone should ever write my life story, for whatever reason there might be, Zenobia would be between each line of pain and glory, because she's the best thing that ever happened to me. Thank you very much.
Earl G. Graves, you are a son of Bedford-Stuyvesant in New York City, who has scaled the heights of American capitalism and journalism. Your inspired creation of Black Enterprise magazine in 1970 has been a model and a beacon to countless millions of black Americans of every age. You have created a following of African Americans who believe and pursue not only the American dream, but also a belief that its benefits should be for all people. Your ministry of self-reliance, thoughtful ambition, and financial independence was spawned in your service as an assistant to the late heroic Robert F. Kennedy. All historically black colleges and universities can take pride in your tutelage from one of our own, Morgan State University in Baltimore. You have been a missionary for black economic participation as a member of the boards of Chrysler, American Airlines, Aetna, and other corporate giants. In practicing what you preach, you also lead the largest minority-controlled Pepsi-Cola franchise in the United States. In 1999, the NAACP recognized your service and leadership to the nation by bestowing its Spingarn Medal, the highest achievement award for African Americans. Loud hosannas have been sung to you by the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal in their bestseller lists for your book, How to Succeed in Business Without Being White, and also by the U.S. Department of Commerce, the City of New York, and the National Conference for Community and Justice. As a mark of special grace for Wilberforce, we proudly welcome your return here, since being among the first participants in the John F. Morning Senior Lecture Series. Mr. President, I have the honor of presenting Earl G. Graves for the degree Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters.
Earl Graves, as a humanitarian, as a personal friend, and as one who has demonstrated excellence in the field of business and charted the way for persons to be able to know that it is possible for all people of all races to be a participant in the great American dream. It is with great honor and pleasure that I, as President of Wilberforce University, present to you the honorary degree Doctor of Humane Letters, together with all rights, privileges, honors appertaining thereto, on this, the first day of May, 2004.
Church and society are indeed richer for the contributions of noble women. Institutions honor themselves when they honor noble individuals. Vashti Murphy McKenzie, a graduate of the University of Maryland with a Master of Divinity degree from the Howard University School of Divinity and a Doctor of Ministry degree from the United Theological Seminary in Dayton, served for 10 years as pastor of the historic 103-year-old Payne Memorial AME Church, where she increased the membership from 330 to 1,700 and increased the property value from $1.6 million to $5.6 million. Her ministry extended beyond the walls as a dedicated, committed ecumenist and author of the distinguished book Not Without a Struggle. It has been through three printings. In addition, she was named as the top Ebony's 1997 list of the 15 greatest African-American female preachers. A creative, visionary pastor, an energized, innovative community leader, a dedicated, committed ecumenist, the spiritual leader of more than 200,000 women of Delta Sigma Theta sorority, of which her late grandmother was a founder, an electrifying speaker, a dynamic spiritual preacher, a loving wife, and a devoted mother. Vashti Murphy McKenzie made history in July 2000 when she became the 117th elected and consecrated bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the first woman to be so honored in its 213-year history. Mr. President, I have the distinct honor of presenting Vashti Murphy McKenzie for the Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters degree.
Bishop Vashti Murphy McKenzie, it is with great pleasure this day to another friend I present the Doctor of Humane Letters together with the rights and privileges, honors appertaining thereto on this, the first day of March 2004. God bless you.
Dr. Flake and the distinguished members of the staff and faculty, to the class of 2004 and assembled family members and friends, encouragement comes in many forms. A thank you note for a kindness that you have forgotten, a letter of support that you didn't expect, a standing ovation, a pat on the back, a high five. All of these things are encouragement. Thank you for this honor, this honorary degree, and I receive it as an encouragement on behalf of all women who have to fly in the face of the wind, have to fly without a tailwind to push them along. To fly in the face of the headwind means there are no books for you to read for where you are. There are no videotapes to observe to describe the place that you're in. There are no mentors who have walked before you. And so I receive this as an encouragement to fly in the headwinds of life so that the sisters who are in this class will have an easy flight as they soar to the pinnacle of their achievement. God bless you and thank you.
I have the great privilege of presenting Dr. Yvonne Walker Taylor, President Emeritus of Wilberforce University, a distinguished contributor to the rich heritage of Wilberforce through a career spanning many generations of students and several decades in years as an instructor, instructional leader, administrator, and president of Wilberforce University. We believe she was born for such a time as that. Dr. Walker Taylor, has received many honors and special recognitions, both throughout the Miami Valley, the state of Ohio, and the nation. Her mark is left upon such institutions, not only as Wilberforce, but as the African American Museum in Wilberforce, where she served as chair of the board for a number of years. She is well known throughout African Methodism as the first woman elected to the Judicial Council of our church. Not only does she hold that first, but she holds also the first as being the first woman elected president of Wilberforce University. Not only that first, but the first daughter of a president to succeed her father as president of Wilberforce University. Her father, as you know, the late Bishop D. Armand Walker, who was my president at Wilberforce, was the 10th president of Wilberforce University, and Dr. Walker Taylor was the 16th president of this institution. Her mark also has been made on the church and other institutions with which she has been affiliated. She has taught and mentored and counseled with several of the outstanding leaders, not only of our church, but of churches throughout the land. We know her well. We love her deeply. We respect her profoundly. This talented and skillful practitioner of the teaching art, this mentor to those needing mentoring, this committed and loyal daughter of Wilberforce, this golden soror of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. I had to say that because my wife and three daughters are members of that group. And I wanted to go back home tonight. Mr. President, I have the high honor of presenting Yvonne Walker Taylor for the Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters degree.
Dr. Yvonne Walker Taylor, little could I have known some 40 years ago that the day would come when I would be presenting an honorary degree to my English teacher and my lit teacher. I honor you on behalf of the university, but I consider it a personal honor for someone who would come to the classroom and at the hour of the class's beginning, shut the door, let us know that you had to be on time, told us that if we took more than three cuts, we'd flunk the course, and if we earned the grade, we would receive it. I'm honored today that I got two B's from you because I know that I earned them. On behalf of Wilberforce University, together with the rights, privileges, and honors appertaining thereto, I am overjoyed to present to a quintessential lady, a woman of grace and dignity, a woman that I just appreciate so dearly, Dr. Yvonne Walker Taylor, this honorary doctor.
Thank you. You heard that word he used, quintessential. You know what it means? Well, I think I have to look it up. I think it's something good, though. It's really an honor to be awarded a degree from your own institution, beside the one that I earned sitting where you're sitting now. But this one, I didn't have to work so hard for. Thank you so very much. Bless the class. You're looking wonderful. I see a lot of girls, a lot of men. Go do something.
Greetings. This indeed is a joyous day, one that the Lord has made. Would the graduating class of 2004 please rise? Mr. President, I present to you the graduating class of 2004, having been approved by the faculty and the Board of Trustees.
Members of the class of 2004, of Wilberforce University. These are most trying times. It is the year of a presidential election. It is a year when many young men and women your age on the battlefields in Afghanistan and Iraq and other places in the world. You are blessed to be able to stand in this place and not be confronted with the everyday struggle between life and death that they face. You have heard a challenge this morning from Bishop Dr. Vashti McKenzie. You have heard the challenge this afternoon from the Honorable Earl Graves. The question for you becomes one of, what do you do with the resources? What do you do with the degree? What do you do with what you have gained from your years and from the experience that you've had at Wilberforce University? May I challenge you to understand that having this diploma, this degree, is not sufficient in and of itself to give to you what you need in order to survive in a world where competition is so great. You must develop the drive, as Bishop McKenzie said this morning, a sense of purpose. Know who you are, have a sense of what your purpose is, and then believe enough in yourself that regardless of what kind of barriers you face, what kind of strongholds are before you, dare to believe that you have the power to overcome, the power to tear them down, and the power to become what God intends for you to be. Let these years not be wasted, the energy, the effort on behalf of your professors and others who have tried to make a contribution by seeding something into your life. The money that has been spent, whether it was money from your mothers or your fathers or even your financial aid package, the reality is these resources will have to be paid back. Make sure that you take full advantage of every opportunity that is presented to you and understand that the best way to prepare yourself to survive in the world in which we live today is to create as many options for yourself as you possibly can. I pray Godspeed for you. I pray God will bless you with every good and perfect gift. You have earned the right to wear the Wilberforce University degree, to carry the Wilberforce University degree, and to go forth into the world and pronounce yourself graduates of this great and cherished institution. Thank you. Members of the class of 2004, we hereby confer upon you the degrees in the particular fields for which you have labored and worked with all of the rights and privileges appertaining thereto on behalf of the Trustee Board of Wilberforce University and the State of Ohio. You may now turn your tassels as members of the graduating class of 2004.
Please be seated. Okay. Would all the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts please stand? We gotta do the part there and two.
They gotta do the hoodie, right?
Would all please sit down. Would all the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science please rise? Mr. President, I present unto you this graduating class. Would all the candidates please rise at this time? We will now do the hooding ceremony. Is that, come here? Are you counting?
Candidates, please get ready for the count. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10.
Please be seated. Candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts, please rise.
Nicole S. Arnold. The Wendy Aquila Bob Magna Cum Laude. Kevin DeAndre Butler. Rayshawn Jermaine Craddock. Orlando Crosby. Chanel. Summer Chanel Davis. Hi. Heather Michelle Day. Tiffany Anita Dean. Senabu J. Summa Cum Laude. Karen L. Dukes. Kareem D. Fulford. Kimberly Joyce Gary. Candy Carmen Gooden. Reginald L. Griffin. Rayshawn Hayes. Jermika Louise Hood. Brianna Jeanette Huddleston. Rhonda Michelle Jackson Magna Cum Laude. Devlin Dion Jeter. Yeah. Catrice Renee Kirk Magna Cum Laude. Tanisha Jeanette Cullum. Devon Miles. Wait till they settle down. Clarence J. Miller. Kayleen G. Miller, magna cum laude. Shamara Monet Mitchell. Janice Marie Moore.
Hey, baby.
Randy Monroe Moore Jr. Diamond Antoinette Morgan, cum laude. LaShonda Monique Nicholson. Willie Raheem Patton, cum laude. Leonard N. Pinkard the second. Jason E. Randall. James Abraham Riggins, magna cum laude. Sasha Odalis Rincon, magna cum laude. Benice C. Robertson. Georgia Robinson.
Oh, you're easy.
Nicole A. Stevens. Sonia Marie Stratford. Candy Ryan Strickland.
Come on, baby. Women now. LaShawn.
Tierra LaShawn Strickland.
There's my son.
Lee Williams III, magna cum laude. Crystal Jerry Williamson.
Arnisa.
Arnisa Marie Wilson.
Please be seated. Would the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science please rise?
Kevin Carl Adkins. Beatrice Denise Austin. Terry Miller Barker. Edith and Jeanette Bates Patterson. Yolanda Annette Bean. James McNeil Bell. Mark Anthony Bell. Sue Ann Betts Strotter. Angela Y. Bickham Birdsong. Tanya Lee Black.
Tanya
Shaque Bodie. Tonetta Bolden. Jonathan G. Bond.
You don't want Angel?
Cassiopeia Angel Bonner. Ebony Nicole Booth.
Chloe C. Daly.
Chloe C. Daly. Cheryl E. Bradley. Stephanie Nicole Bradley. Patricia Brantley. Eric A. Bridges. Randy K. D. Brown. Sonia D. Brown. Jamie Burks. Pamela May Burns. Amelia L. Butler. Robert L. Carter, Jr.
Now, wait a minute now. You gotta have your glory, too. Is it Kaysen or
Lawrence S. Kaysen. Karen Yvette Chavez. Melissa Michelle Childress. Rachel N. Chilton.
Jason Christopher Clark, Sr. Carla Yvonne Clay. Denise M. Coggins. Debbie K. Cole. Matthew Cole. Capri Monet Coleman. Jamila Marie Nicole Collins. Nancy K. Collins. Tony M.
Jason Jones. Cherie Bonet Crombie. Kimberly Cunningham. Mark Timothy Davis, Sr. Terry Sharif Davis. Brenda Dawson. Thaddeus E. Dawson, Jr. Michelle Lynn DeMarcia. Lucretia Deshan Dewberry. Shireen N. Douglas. Letitia Renee Drew. Eddie M. Dunbar, Sr. Starlin C. Dumas. Eddie Edwards IV, cum laude. Kristen G. Irvin. Jean A. Evans II. Chantel Lynette Fancher. David J. Farley. Cynthia C. Figgins. Maurice L. Fitzgerald. Michael Anthony Fleming. Trinity Laniel Fletcher. Deborah Ann Foster. Latasha Javon Foster. Talithia Fountain. Erica Somerville Fox. Kimberly A. Fullen. George L. Gagel. Mary Margaret Galantine. Raquel I. Gamble. Robin A. Gilchrist. Dorothy J. Gilliam. L. Timothy Glimp III. Sherry Lynn Golson. Danielle Marquita Graham. Jesse James Gregory Jr. Daryl W. Haley. Abdi Hassan. Nicole Marie Hatton, cum laude. Rosalind Hoggerbrook. Carolyn L. Henry. Charles E. Hightower. Anissa Shanae Heinzman. Janelle Selena Hocker. You look beautiful. Virginia Lee Hodge. Derek Eugene Hogue. Tasha R. Holston. Lucretia Nicole Horse. Rita Renee Horton. Nancy P. Houston. Nakia Nichelle Hughes. Tanisha Nicole Hughes. Shalonda Renee Gilkey. Tiffany Michelle Ingram. Arnella Renee Irby. Karen D. Jackson. Philip D. Jackson. Carla L. Jameson. Michael Jenkins. Betty J. Jones. Donna Marte Jones. Paul Milton Jordan. Sabrina Zanata Joseph. Heather Malik Herber. Gwendolyn King. Kristen Ann King. Lori Marie King.
Lauren Lamont Lash. Millard Frank Latimer. Melissa Nicole Liggins. Donald Little Jr. Rhonda L. Long. Maddie Grace Lundy. Tracy Lyons. Brian C. Mackey. Cleo Matthews. Kimberly T. McClendon. Nicole Denise McDonald. Shatan E. McGraw. Tiara Marie Melton. Brooke Janelle Middleton. Sonia Latrice Miller. Gary Moore II. Lloyd Moore. Tammy Moore Hamilton. Sally M. Moser. Barbara S. Mosley. Corvette Hall Mosley. Timothy Naeem. Pamela Renee Neal Money. Delia Naive Yvonne Newsom. Claudia Heather Dawn Oak. Ryan Tennille Odister. Angela C. Odom. Deanna Renee Orr. Amber Sherelle Osborne. Isaac Ayo Ayawale. Karen Lynn Hunnall Palmer. Gwendolyn Milligan Phelps. Angela Lavette Phillips. Weston Lewis Philpott III. Damon J. Pierce. DeMarcel Ray.
Gary B. Reed, Jr. Marvin Leon Reed, Jr. Donald Draxton Respress, Jr. Angela C. Richards. Rodney Thomas Riddle. Rashandra M. Riley. Gloria J. Robinson. Kim Renita Robinson. Florence Robinson Render. Sherry Laurice Rose. Kyle David Rodkin. Marilyn Renee Rucker. David L. Sandridge. Asia Janae Sanders. Ryan S. Scarberry. Daryl L. Smith. Deborah Lynn Smith. Ebony Shantae Smith. Jakim Renee Spearman. Deneen D. Spear. Amber Ray Stargill, cum laude. Linda Joan Stevens. Gary Stone. Sherelle Angenise Stroud. Gregory Lamar Sudbury. Rhonda Lynn Sumlin Johnson. Charles H. Sykes, Jr. Sherry Nate Thomas. Tia Tanisha Thomas. Patrice Ann Thornton. Alonda V. Talbert, magna cum laude. LaTanya Janice Truett. Sowit Sagai. Timothy L. Tubbs. Joseph Tumeo. Nina Marie Valentine. Kimberly Ann Walker. Patrick R. Walker. Laverna Wall. Jason Timothy Walsh. Chandra Elizabeth Francois Walton. Deshanta Warren. Robin Marie Waitman. Leonida Marquita White. Randy L. White. Robin Chanel White. Beverly Jean Williams. Billy Lee Williams. Jennifer Nicole Williams. Crystal Nicole Williams. Terrell S. Williams. Christopher Sean Stephen Woodford. Cynthia Worthington. Danjay Marquette Wynn. Jerron Lee Yarborough. And Kelly Annette Young.
Will the graduates please be seated?
You have now received your degrees. I've already given you your charge. You've already turned your tassels, but stand one more time. Let's put our hands together for the class of 2004. Thank you. At this time, we ask all the members of the faculty to stand. Let's give them a big hand, all of the faculty. Thank you for your participation in the life of these young people. You may go to your seats for just a moment. At this time, we'd like to recognize a special class. 60 years ago, they graduated from Wilberforce University. It is my understanding that there are only two of them left, and they are here, members of the class of 1944. Where's the class of there they are. From the class of 1944, we're certainly glad and happy to see you. And we want you to know that their class is few in numbers, but they give significantly to the university. Thank you very much. At this time, we present to you the head of the president of the National Alumni Chapter, Colonel William Lee.
Good afternoon. At this time, I will administer the alumni pledge to the graduates of the class of 2004. First, I'd like to say Dr. Graves, Bishop McKenzie, and the other honorees, we welcome you to as a member of the Alumni Association. Will all the Wilberforce University alumni please stand? Not yet. Thank you very much. Now, will the members of the graduating class of 2004 please stand? Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I do hereby swear my allegiance to the Alumni Association, whose purpose is to actively assist in promoting programs which are beneficial to and in the best interest of Wilberforce University. Further, I faithfully pledge to follow and uphold the constitutions and bylaws of the Wilberforce University Alumni Association. Being mindful that we are now confronted by life in the larger world and being conscious of our obligation to be both faithful followers and dependable leaders, we, the members of the class of 2004, do hereby covenant with one another and with all other alumni at Wilberforce University to be worthy sons and daughters of our alma mater, to realize in ourselves high standards of integrity and competence, to fulfill in ourselves her traditions of unselfish service to mankind, and in the days and years that be ahead, to meet with dignity and fortitude whatever comes to me personally. So help me God. It is indeed my pleasure now to welcome you as members of the Alumni Association of Wilberforce University. With all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto, please be seated. I would like to at this time invite you to come and participate in our annual conference, which would be held July the 28th. August the 1st in St. Louis, Missouri. And on behalf of the Alumni Association, I wish you good luck and Godspeed. Thank you.
Well, we come near to the end of this commencement exercise, and we are certainly grateful for all who have been a part of it, all who have participated. We want to thank Wright State University for opening its doors to us. Thank the persons from Wilberforce who are responsible for program planning and for assisting in hospitality, transportation, and other areas that we might be able to celebrate this afternoon. At this time, we will have the singing of the alma mater, after which I'm going to ask the president of Payne Theological Seminary, Dr. Leah Gaskin Fitzhugh, to come forth with the benediction. Our bishop had to leave. Let us now stand together and remove all of our caps, join hands together throughout the sanctuary, throughout the auditorium, as we join together for the singing of the alma mater.
as we prepare for the benediction. To the graduates, you stand today on the rest of your life. You have been equipped by this institution for outstanding service. Nothing can stop you. The rest is up to you. Now, may the grace of God, the almighty communion of the Holy Spirit, and the love of Christ, which allows us unlimited possibilities, be with you and stay with you forevermore. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen.
We ask that the audience will remain in its place as the graduates, faculty, and others in the procession recess.